Welcome, everyone. It's really good to see all of you here in this digital space. Thank you for being with us here at the College of the Arts at University of Florida. We, most of us, are physically located in Gainesville, Florida, on the indigenous lands of the Timucua and Potano peoples. We are gathered from near and far in this virtual space to launch the Center for Art, Migration, and Entrepreneurship. My name, Onye Ozuzu. I am the Dean of the College. I'm also the daughter of an Igbo man, an immigrant from southeastern Nigeria. My mother is a third generation German-American Mennonite from southeastern Ohio, where her master's degree thesis in education focused on the culture and the educational system of the Igbo of southeastern Nigeria. I'm telling this story not to isolate myself through my identity, but to call out among us the ways that our lineages offer threads to the fabric of our potential collective. So right now, I invite each of you to also introduce yourself in the chat, your name, where you're from, what diaspora do you represent, and what influence from it do you bring with you, and how could those influences affect the fabric of our gathering? Go ahead, y'all. Yes, thank you. There we go. So I'm going to tell a bit of a personal narrative, and I trust that the reasons will become clear. Back sometime in the 80s at another Florida institution that shall not be named in the moment, I was an undergraduate English literature major, and I remember turning in an assignment to my American studies professor. At the time, I really didn't have an appreciation of who he was. He was a giant. But I knew that when I was in his class, I literally felt the sensation of light bulbs going off in my head. And so I took every class that could fit in my schedule that he offered. W.T. Lehman was the author of Deliberate Speed, The Origins of a Cultural Style in the American 1950s. And Wood, a year after I graduated that institution with a master's degree in dance, published Raising Cain, Blackface Performance from Jim Crow to Hip Hop. I finally tracked him down and had an email exchange with him today. So Dr. Lehman, if you're here, don't tell me now, but I'm so happy. My assignment was meant to be a piece of critical analysis. I turned in my paper half apologetically and tried to explain why I had taken up such a significant amount of space in an academic document telling a first person narrative. I had included a story of a very early memory of myself struggling with the idea of God. As a solution to the feeling of overwhelm at the vastness of the idea, I sat my stuffed sock monkey, you know the kind, one of those monkeys made by the Swedish immigrants of Rockford, Illinois, with the red heels on the socks that gave the monkeys those red lips. I sat my monkey on my bed and politely requested that God should kindly inhabit the monkey, so that it would be in a size that I could reasonably talk to. Dr. Lehman responded to my apologetic submission by pointing out to me how both my childhood practice of utilizing symbolic materiality as a bridge to spirituality and my paper's use of the personal to represent a conceptual pattern that across a collective, that both actions placed me clearly as a member of the African diaspora, leveraging my culture as a method for engaging and shaping my context. When a migrant group arrives in a new context, they lean on the cultural fabric, the cultural practices that are unique to them, their music, their food, their aesthetics, from Swedish sock knitting techniques to African symbolic traditions. Unique patterns of cultural production spur innovation and produce value. The influence, for instance, of African and Latin music on the music and dance that would become known worldwide as American, jazz, R&B, hip hop, swing, Broadway. This is obvious to all of us. It cannot be overstated. We also know that significant intangible value generation proliferates at the liminal spaces that movements of people etch into our lived experiences. Transcendence from the harsh struggles of life in the fringes of our society made the coolest, the freshest, the next big thing flow continually from those neighborhoods that we called ghettos or barrios or. But not to be directly cash money oriented, but maybe for a second here, each of those forms that I just recognize easily represents multi-billion, if not trillion-dollar enterprise, and we know this, y'all. The worldwide media giant that is the Disney Corporation is in no small part a phenomenon laced with the narratives, the symbols, the songs, and the styles of many intersecting cultural diasporas. Their recent record-breaking release, Black Panther, and the subsequent pitch to the very same market, worldwide market, of a re-released Lion King, and then in quick succession, Beyoncé's album, Black King, are clear examples of the profits to be made from trading on the aesthetic and creative values of a specific cultural diaspora. The question, though, is how and whether the value and the profits generated from diaspora cultures actually return to them to bring wealth and well-being to their communities. When I arrived here in Gainesville in 2018, it was in the 21st year of a career as an artist and educator, and my 10th as an administrator. In my generation of academics, particularly Black and Brown academics, we have worked with our colleagues in predominantly white institutions to facilitate, cultivate, and to make meaningful the aspirations of the Academy's focus on multiculturalism and then on diversity. And now, perhaps in this age where racism is turning our police into murderers in public, we're turning the corner to actually speak overtly about anti-racism on campus. All along, many of us worked and pushed for a deeper focus than mere inclusion into the predominant culture. In my discipline, dance, I worked with my colleagues to demonstrate that inclusion of African dance and jazz and hip hop dance faculty with skin that happened to be melanated was not enough. That the contributions of generations of practitioners, the diasporas that we represent, had to be considered foundational to the American dancing body itself. African dance is at the core of what it means to move like an American. And therefore, it should be foundational in our canon and in our core curriculum. If we could do that, we would be accurately engaging our shared cultural heritages and building capacity for equitable futures, literally into our bodies. And if racism was standing in the way, which it is, than anti-racists we would and have been and will be. Of course, not just because it's the right thing to do, but because it is the method to get to the goal, to the thing of value that it has obscured for too long. As I was arriving here in Gainesville, though, it was beginning to dawn on me that even this simple inclusion of our perspectives into the canons and curricula, that even this is not enough. And in fact, it might even be misleading. Because what if its inclusion segregates it into dance, when perhaps the form actually needs to be in conversation with more disciplines and more expansive ways of knowing? What if what looks like dance to the outside eye might actually function in its own cultural context as politics or as public health? Or as agricultural practice. For instance, we all know this example. When Black and Latino youth in the Bronx created what would become known as hip hop, they were solving complex situational problems, representing in architectural, sociological, and in economic configurations. They were doing so through sophisticated embodied technologies of conflict resolution and participatory learning. When their efforts were then marketed and consumed as music and dance, the loss was not only in the fact that their communities were not equitably compensated, the loss to us all was that the intangible values intrinsic to the practice of hip hop were flattened and neutralized as it became commercialized. Hip hop could have meant so much more to our well-being as a culture. So creative production, when seen through the lens of migration and diaspora culture, expands it beyond the pages, the frames, the stages that we have sorted the so-called arts into in Euro-dominant contexts. If we were to use these lenses, we could flex the full range or more full range of our innovative muscle. We could wave the full fabric of our mingled interactivity in a still intermingling society of peoples, each who came from some place and are each stretching a diaspora of ways of being, seeing, and making into this moment. So this was the thinking with which I arrived here at UF in the College of the Arts, where a Center for Arts and Medicine had already been opening the context for creative practice in health for almost 30 years, where the Digital Worlds Institute, which is this year celebrating its 20th anniversary, had been exploring the frontiers of art, design, communication, and engineering, where two associate deans, Jennifer Setlow and Tony Kulinick, were leading emerging conversations around art and entrepreneurship and art and cultural diaspora. So I figured, hey, this is my new home, naturally. And with that, I'm gonna pass the mic back to Tony to share our next chapter.
Thanks, Sonia. As Dean Azusa said, my name is Tony Kulinick. I'm the Associate Dean for Research and Strategic Initiatives for the College of the Arts. And like everybody in the chat and everybody who's speaking today, I'm also the product of a complicated migratory lineage. As a teenager, my great-grandfather fled what is sometimes Russia and sometimes Poland, depending on the century or the decade in the war. And after his two older brothers were conscripted into the Russian army in the years preceding World War I and then never heard from again, he hid on a produce cart headed for Denmark and he made his way to the US and somehow ended up in northern Michigan and married a woman whose family farmed land there and were provided through the Homestead Act decades earlier, some land to farm. It was a massive privatization and settling act, but it's important to note it's also one that displaced the Chippewa and Ottawa Nation in the region. But back to what Onye was saying. When Onye joined us in the summer of 2018, the College of the Arts was already in the process of shaping a whole greater than the sum of its parts in terms of diaspora. At that time, 28 of our faculty were working in, on, or across the Latin American diaspora, and we had just started systematizing faculty research initiatives and partnerships with other experts on campus, particularly those in the Center for Latin American Studies. The College of the Arts also benefits from 25 successful years of the Center for World Arts, which has provided the college a deep lineage of programming in and across diasporic performance. The Center for Arts Migration and Entrepreneurship continues several of those longstanding programs supported and grown through the Center for World Arts. Onye's experience and work creating innovative futures in and through the African diaspora, combined with our nascent efforts to systematize our expertise across the Latin American diaspora at a uniquely fortuitous moment. Shortly after her arrival, the University of Florida put out a university-wide invitation for audacious, impactful initiatives, moonshots, that would address grand challenges. It also began hiring 500 new faculty to drive bold, distinctive research and creative practice. In partnership with IFES, the Wertheim College of Engineering, the Warrington College of Business, several centers across the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, and the leadership of colleagues like Andrew Tejas, Brenda Chalfin, Juan Gilbert, and Jamie Kraft, we were successful in securing a moonshot designation for our proposal, Migration Redefined, Arts Diaspora, and Entrepreneurship in the 21st Century. Through it, we aimed to shift the dominant narrative so commonly attached to diasporic and migratory communities that come to Florida and the United States. And instead, we recognize them as vital generators of the tangible and intangible values in our economies, cultures, communities that Onye mentioned. Importantly, our goal was never to simply study, but to be active partners with these diasporic and migratory communities horizontally in Florida and beyond, to drive new methods and models that restore the power to generate value back to these culture makers, these entrepreneurs. In short, our goal is and was and is to generate new solutions and alignments of economic and cultural power in partnership with the very cultural producers and entrepreneurs that are shaping our collective global future. So the end result, or really the beginning result, is this new center, the Center for Arts, Migration, and Entrepreneurship. It connects networks of scholars, artists, creatives, entrepreneurs, and advocates to the engines of creative and cultural economics at the heart of migration, and through those networks, builds new possibilities for the cultural and economic innovations developed along the global tributaries of human movement. It's important to note that we didn't get here by ourselves. Knowing that we were entering an intersection of fields, industries, and complex cultural and political dynamics on a global scale, we sought out some of the leading voices driving the future of scholarship and systemic change in diasporic and migratory studies, specifically where they interact with the arts and cultural forms. These include Tommy DeFrance, Chair of African and African American Studies and Professor of Dance and Theater Studies at Duke University, Tim Eatman, the inaugural Dean of the Honors Living Learning Community at Rutgers University, Newark, Stephanie McKee Anderson, who is the Executive Artistic Director for Junebug Productions, Rocky Monroe, the Co-Director of Academic Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, and Associate Professor of Dance at Columbia College, Chicago, Ramon Rivera-Savera, Chair of Performance Studies in the School of Communication at Northwestern University, and Tamara Underreiner, Associate Dean for Academic Affairs with Graduate College and Associate Professor in the School of Film, Dance, and Theater at Arizona State University. When they joined us, we called them our stylists because we asked these six individuals to help us think through the assets we had, our faculty's research, to think through that faculty research as a sort of scholarly wardrobe, if you will, to help us identify from an external perspective which pieces could combine in innovative new research outfits, initiatives, and crucially, which pieces were missing. Their generous work helped us ethically and responsibly position the mission and purpose of the center within our own institution, but importantly, also within the global networks of scholars, artists, activists, and entrepreneurs already working in the space. And to that end, we were going to be joined by one of our stylists tonight, Dr. Ramon Rivera-Savera, but alas, a perfect exemplar of our times, connected, broken, fixed again, and broken again. He's kindly provided a video because his internet is choppy. So here we go.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ramon Rivera-Cervera, and I am Professor of Performance Studies in Art Theory and Practice at Northwestern University, where I also direct the Puerto Rican Arts Initiative. It is my absolute pleasure to be here to mark the inauguration of the Center for Art, Migration, and Entrepreneurship at the University of Florida. I was there as a stylist on the invitation of Dean Ozuzu, spending a couple of days with other colleagues, thinking along with some of your faculty and staff as the ideas were beginning to germinate about the possibility of what this center was to be and what it could do at the University of Florida. I want to commend you and congratulate you in achieving so quickly the materialization of this platform. As a scholar whose work focuses on 20th and 21st century performance in North America and the Caribbean, and with special attention on the ways categories of race, ethnicity, gender, and sexuality are negotiated across networks and borders through circuits of migration and circulation and exchange, I am particularly excited for the existence of the center. My work with communities of art and culture makers and participants yields traditional scholarship in the form of articles and books documenting, analyzing, and theorizing the ways performance and other creative practices are shaped by and intervene in our contemporary political economies. I am a performance ethnographer as well, and as such, my methodologies involve co-participant, collaborative, creative engagements with artists that result in commissions, exhibitions, and presentations, as well as publications, focusing on the work of arts and migration. from the development of the Performance in the Borderlands project at Arizona State University to my current work with the Puerto Rican Arts Initiative, I have worked to center the work of artists who, through their practice, make sense of the moves and movements that shape migratory experience. Thinking about the ways that art and culture can document, critique, and help transform our understandings of ourselves and our communities, the inequities, historical and contemporary, of world and national economies, and the aesthetic as both the shape of things and a valuable tool from which to conceive and enact change in the world. You can only imagine the excitement for me when Dino Zuzu invited me to come and learn from all of you and think through the ways in which you inter-articulate the very keywords that constitute the name of the center. Thinking creatively about an expanded idea of what art is, beyond but not ignorant to the significance of art markets in our contemporary world, valuing the contributions of migratory communities to art plays, understanding that unless we claim indigenous heritage, we're all in some ways the result of migratory movements into these lands, and thinking about entrepreneurship expansively with beyond notions of neoliberal economics and fantasy dreams about the creative class animating all that is the contemporary economy, but not forgetting of the fact that art takes and mobilizes resources, including economies, is a brilliant way to center a practice that is also anchored on notions of equity and inclusion. And for that, I'm extremely excited that your leadership, that your focus inaugurates with an emphasis on movement, that looks at both the circulation of people as a way of also understanding its interpretation and manifestation in choreographic practice. I think Kudus Onikeku is a fantastic inaugural artist in residence to work with in this project. I am excited to see all that you are about to venture into. And I am very much looking forward to collaborating in this venture with you. Again, congratulations, and I'm so looking forward to all that is to come.
Wow, I'm grinning from ear to ear. Am I on? Okay, yes. Well, I'm just grinning from ear to ear. I can't get my thoughts right. Ramon just landed it. I'm so grateful to him for recording that statement for us. So next, I'm about to introduce another powerhouse that we are so fortunate to have with us, the inaugural director of the Center for Art, Migration, and Entrepreneurship. We are so fortunate to have my brother, my friend, Osha B. Craig, here at the College of the Arts to lead the opening of our new center. And he really opened it. He arrived and had to figure out how to get paint on the walls, y'all. So he is a multi-talented administrator, engineer, musician, arts presenter, entrepreneur, and arts advocate. He has over 20 years of experience crafting shared visions and strategic directions and effectively working with and leading arts programs and organizations. And I'll let him tell you the rest. Osha B., take it away.
Thank you so much, Onye. Thank you all so much for being here. I come to you tonight first representing the Meherrin Indian Nation of what is now North Carolina and Virginia, and the African American diasporas on my mother's side. I come here representing the Trinidadian, Yoruba, Lukumi, and African American diasporas on my father's side. I come here today first as a drummer, a percussionist, musician, and artist who has migrated from Brooklyn, New York to Gainesville, Tallahassee, Philadelphia, South Florida, Central Florida, Virginia, and now back to Gainesville. And in all that time, I have no memory in my life where I was not making music on a drum, a bell, or a gourd. For me, growing up in Brooklyn, New York, one of the epicenters of the African drum and dance cultural arts movement gave me roots and branches throughout the African diaspora. This allowed me to learn, to teach, to see and experience the world in rich ways as both an artist and an entrepreneur, and to recognize the unique value of arts and artists on cultures, economies across the globe. This powerful idea that is Kane is extremely relevant, ambitious, and so needed for this time. I am so honored to be the inaugural director and inspired to lead this powerful shared vision. I am proud of all we have accomplished in this first year, even amidst the COVID pandemic, and excited to share some of our work with you this evening. Let me first introduce our team. As you've heard, our inaugural maker is a phenom, Mr. Kudus Onikeku, Artistic Director of Q Dance Center Lagos. His partner, Hajirat Ali, who serves as research assistant in CAME and is also the executive director of Q Dance Center Lagos. And Kathy McKee, our fantastic do-it-all administrative specialist. What we're talking about at the core for CAME is about future making. It is about partnerships, network cultivation, projects that create effective new models and power alignments. One of the examples of that is a project that emerged just in May of this year. The pandemic caused the cancellation of events, shows, concerts, museums, theaters, all directly affecting creatives in the gig economy and artists who would typically be working in communities and in school settings. CAME quickly responded. The development of the Virtual Creative Arts Academy is an innovative and sustainable solution, a virtual arts infusion program designed to provide creative making experiences for both middle school and high school students through an online platform. This interactive platform provides opportunity for students to get up, move, all while engaging in global art forms and STEAM activities. This program is led by affiliate faculty members right here in the center, Dion Champion, along with Alana Jackson and Rachel Carrico. It was developed in partnership with Howard Bishop Middle School and the Community Schools Partnership Schools Network, really in major part to our partnership with Mr. Andrew Tejas, Director of Collaborative Initiatives right here at University of Florida, the Center for Arts and Medicine, thank you so much, Director Jill Sankey, and the Digital Worlds Institute, thank you so much, Director James Oliverio. The next thing I want to talk about is where we are with this initiative of AI for Africa. And AI for Africa, CAME is right now developing a partnership with this group, which is led by Dr. S. Amare, Associate Professor of Dance at UC Irvine. They are an interdisciplinary group of innovators made up of artists, industry leaders, scholars, conducting research in law, economics, computer science, and design, who are interested in bringing African perspectives and experiences to the discord around AI. Its main goal is to promote data science, make value creation from AI a tangible reality, and to create a dynamic network of people interested in affecting the field of AI, its impact, and innovations taking place on the continent and also throughout the diasporas. Given this unparalleled support and infrastructure emerging for AI research right here at the University of Florida, the focus of the Center for Arts Migration and Entrepreneurship, we are proud to be collaborators and to host this intersector multi-university industry building initiative. Next, I want to talk about the Africa Contemporary Arts Consortium. Originally founded in 2004 in response to the lack of viable exchange programs for US artists from Africa, the Contemporary Arts Consortium was a landmark program designed to initiate and sustain an exchange of arts and ideas between artists, arts organizations, and public communities throughout the United States and the African continent. The Center for World Arts was a founding member and a leader of the consortium. Though the planning convening that was originally scheduled for the spring in Marrakesh was postponed due to the pandemic, CAME is honored to be a leading partner in redefining and growing the next iteration for the consortium. And last but certainly not least, I want to talk about the Attunda project. This is the main project for our maker in residence, and we are excited about what is happening here. Attunda is a research project that seeks to develop interactions with cutting edge technologies using blockchain, artificial intelligence, virtual and augmented reality to both document, identify, analyze, experiment, reproduce, and share dance traditions across time and space, building a bridge between technology and African diasporic dances and cultures. Attunda is being developed as a creative social media platform that we believe will be a game changer. Caduceus is gonna share more with you about that later, and so I'll not take his thunder. Looking forward on how the program is made up, we look at our four parts. First, as we've talked about, our Maker in Residence program. And what makes this unique is that this is a 3-year appointment, not just for a semester or for a year, but 3 years we have Caduceus here with us. This is to work as an incubator for the maker, be it an artist, an entrepreneur in creative industries, scholar, or even designer, whose work is consciously located within the cultural diaspora and engaged with the context, impacts, and opportunities of migration and entrepreneurship in the creative fields. The next aspect is faculty-driven research. Affiliate and project faculty come from a variety of disciplines across the university and drive independent and collaborative research in an array of forms, often directly with communities or scholarship and industry partners relevant to the center's mission. Then we have cultural production. The center is so happy to continue to house the creative production for students, such as Agbe Didi, the Harm Museum of Dance, the Brazilian Music Institute, and Jaca de Brazil. For us, our community responsive programming is the last element I want to touch on. And that's focused on the center's community partners in Gainesville, in the US, and globally, our valued collaborators and experts in their own right. As such, the center works with artists and cultural producers globally. And these collaborations often manifest in joint research ventures or programs. One of the things that happened this spring is we gathered faculty from across the university. And in that gathering, talked about opportunities for faculty to get engaged with the center. CAME selected an initial cohort of scholars with related research, teaching, and service interest to become affiliate or courtesy faculty members and help to advance CAME's objectives through scholarly projects. Our faculty come from departments across the campus, such as the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, the Center for African Studies, the Center for European Studies, the Center for Gender, Sexuality, and Women's Studies, the Center for Latin American Studies, the Departments of Anthropology, Geography, and Political Science. Obviously, many faculty members from right here in the College of the Arts, representatives from the university libraries, the College of Law, the College of Business, inclusive of the Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. We are so excited about that. And on top of gathering that cohort, we already have 14 projects that have been funded that faculty are researching right now. I'm just going to touch on just a few of those. The first one is documenting histories, farm workers in Florida during COVID-19. This is led by Margarita Vargas Betancourt and John Nimmers. And this project will create an archive of relevant digital content that captures the impact of COVID-19 on farm workers in Florida. It is part of the Florida Latin American and Caribbean Diaspora Initiative and will be housed in the university libraries. The next is Jumpstart 2021. This is led by Anna Holcomb, along with Jamie Kraft, Brian Slauson, and Melissa May White. Jumpstart is an annual design thinking competition that empowers students in the arts, engineering, entrepreneurship through collaborative exploration, discovery, divergent thinking, and professional mentorship. Additionally, I want to talk about inter and transdisciplinary methodological models for respectful community engagement. This is led by Maria Rogal, along with Laura Gonzalez and Dory Griffin. This project seeks to decenter knowledge production, to acknowledge local expertise gained via lived experience, to question equity and equitable engagement. The project will realize narratives of history, place, identity, and recognize multiple voices, including those who have been historically marginalized. And with that, I want to welcome one of our affiliate faculty members now, Heidi Powell, to briefly share about her work. Thank you all so much. Heidi, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Thank you so much. And thank you for inviting me. And I'm so excited to be a part of CAME and what it's all about. I have a couple of slides, hopefully Brandon will put up. A little context about my research and practice. I explore cultural continuity through the arts. And what that means is that the arts in a culture help convey and maintain an identity for that culture over generations as well as centuries. And the arts really become a form of generational identifiers passed down through informal or formal education. And then I use the word resonate to kind of describe this process because it means like sympathetic vibration. So as we look at culture and the arts, and as we look at specific cultural genres, this idea of resonating is kind of a metaphor for how people come together. And another way I think about it is also this idea of historical perpetual echo that reshapes itself over time and reflects back in the contemporary. I view this idea as a meeting place for common understandings of culture, but something that also offers the outside, those outside the culture, glimpses of what's within the culture. It's a situational embedding of identity markers related to knowledge and experience and place. I began with this in mind, thinking about like virtual exchange and the idea of virtual exchange and how it can be used in my research process. Sorry about that. Virtual exchange is kind of a technology mode that combines the deep impact of intercultural dialogue and exchange with the broad reach of technology. And with these things in mind, I developed a thing called piggybacking. And it's really not anything I developed, it's just something I named because it's something we already really do every day. And this is the slides that you're seeing are kind of related to this very thing. I began to give this idea of piggybacking educational objectives. And what it is piggybackers are students who use their phones to join in with students or faculty on site in a place of engagement. So in piggybacking, we use more of an open framework for research and teaching, and it's really redefined by our objectives and outcomes and really integrates collaboration. And it's really more fluid and emergent. We need to embrace the idea that as researchers, teachers, and learners, we'll not reach the same outcomes, no matter our backgrounds or intersectionality, yet we strive for inclusivity, as all the arts do, and it's typically faculty-led and student-driven. So I began to develop piggybacking more concretely, and these are images from Antigua Guatemala, and I took students down on a project for alfombras. Alfombras are these magic carpets, or I call them magic carpets. They're made of sawdust. And there's an example there at the bottom of students working on the alfombra, as well as others piggybacking in through their cell phone using Zoom. And then also the carpet in its final production there of what they created and how they created it. The second slide is really about a more local type of piggybacking, where students in China were able to piggyback with each other on a 30-minute journey. I was tasking students with engaging in the lives of their peers. They could virtually follow a peer. This was done in WeChat in China, and have to creatively document how they see the other's journey. This is about cultural learning, but even more so about developing a deeper understanding of each other's lives, cultures, identities, and everyday experiences. And then they have to create they have to use a creative method, whether dance or music or drawing, in this case, a simple line drawing, to convey how they experience that journey with others. And I'll just finish up with this idea. There are three takeaways for piggybacking, which is really cool. One is just that it's geared toward everyday tech use. It can be absolutely used in the arts in every form. It bridges remote and on-site participants. So people who might be on-site, like in Guatemala, they can join in. Remote piggybackers can join in on the activity or what's happening. It also fosters collaboration and creative and cultural learning as a form of inquiry in the arts. And I believe that being a part of the center, as we talk about our experiences in the arts from local to global cultures, whether it's art making, looking, talking about, experiencing, or valuing, that it brings about new conversations and understandings. What makes the work we are doing transformative is that we get to explore and take risks as researchers, teachers, and learners. And we get to move away from that kind of passive and observational to really the kind of group-oriented problem-solving things as a basis, research and teaching as a basis for understanding others and how they see the world. It gets people invested and invested in each other. And I think regardless of difference or otherness, these are investments that create change for us and for those around us. So that's all I have, but thank you. I was being really quick, trying to.
Thank you so much, Heidi. I'm gonna pass back to Onye.
Can everyone hear me now? All right. Thanks so much, Heidi. Tony and Oshibi for all of that rich information. So that's us. So far, so good. We're about a year into it. And thank you all for being here to help us officially cut the digital ribbon and open the Center for Art Migration and Entrepreneurship. We've just laid out a lot of information, from large sweeping ideas to the expanse of diaspora across time and space, to piggybacking with student partners, getting access to cultural sites and educational sites, to all of the wonderful projects that our first inaugural group of affiliate faculty are going to be working on in the container of the center. But we'd like to turn this conversation over to the group and answer questions or hear any comments that you all would like to make.
So the best way to do that, everyone, is to land them in the chat. I think we have 162 people, and in the interest of making it so people don't have to try and all get through the door at the same time, please just do drop them in the chat if you have any questions. Thanks.
Okay, y'all, you know I need an amen. So go ahead and unmute yourself and put your voices in the room, please.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen.
Can I hear it again?
Yes.
Yes, thank you.
Yes. Go.
Any questions, any comments, any cautions, any commands, requests?
Well, now we've got some questions coming in. Maybe we should start with some of the more specific ones. We have a question from Matthew Shinoda. Welcome, Matthew. It's a question for Heidi. It says, Heidi, could you speak a bit more to the historical perpetual echo and how you see it playing out in various contexts?
Sure. I think the historical, what I think about when I think about the historical perpetual echo is, it's kind of like, you know, the game we used to play when we were kids with, where you share a word with someone and it changes over time. And when it gets to the end of the person, it's a little bit morphed. I think as we start, for example, Alfombra started using really organic materials, and then now they're actually use sawdust and we buy dyes. Same with the potlatch up in the Northwest coast. The potlatch started with this idea of woven baskets, and traditionally now they use laundry baskets made of plastic. So these they're echoing the same thing, but it's done a little bit differently, a little bit changed from the original source or from during the time when, you know, of colonialization and when things kind of were subsumed from indigenous and local communities geographically. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you. We had another great one here. Another great question was about collaboration. How can people collaborate, particularly faculty and graduate students?
Collaboration opportunities. The first would to be reach out to the contact information you see on the slide now. We are gathering our affiliates coming up on September 10th, and we'll begin to work out how we're going to engage as far as connecting around campus broadly. But I would say first, reach out to us here and tell us about the work that you have going on so that we can get you connected to some of our affiliates and the project that they are working on.
Another great question from Eddie Daniels. What will be the primary public-facing outcomes from the center? So public-facing outcomes from the center.
I think that's a great question. I think we are really in the early stages of it. Some of the examples that I talked about in the future workspace are all, to me, very much public-facing. The Virtual Creative Arts Academy, the initiative with AI for Africa, the Contemporary African Consortium, looking at those type of programs where we are not just doing work that's here on campus, but looking towards our community, whether it be local in this area, in the state, and then globally. I believe that those are the places that I look at that. And then I welcome you all to go and check out our website. We have already, with these 14 programs, we have a lot of depth and breadth of research that is going on. And these projects that we funded for faculty in this last cycle really are seed funding to then go out and expand the impact of those places. And so to say one area, I would say that we're too early to say that. I think that our cultivation around the networks that we have already gathered with Caduce, our maker, and our affiliates, that what those things look like 6 months from now, a year from now, in many ways, the sky is the limit. And I think that the flexibility of thought and concept that we've utilized to even do this launch virtually as we are today speaks to really a new and amazing horizon for the center.
Should we?
I'd like to say
something, or should we?
Yes.
I want to just double what Shubi says. I think an important thing about the center, in my view, this is Professor Wilson Tremura with the School of Music and the Center for Latin American Studies, is our ability to use performance as research. I think that's one of the elements that, as a ethnomusicologist, most of the research that I do is written articles or books, but also I see performance a very important component of the center, and also spreading the music that and the arts that we already have on campus to audiences abroad through technology and other opportunities. Just a couple of words. Thank you.
Thanks, Wilson. I want to remind everyone that this is, we're just kind of wrapping up the opening, our halftime. We're going to take a little bit of a break so people can get water and stretch your legs. And then we're going to have our maker in residence give us a deep dive into his work. There'll be a performance, sort of a showing of a short film. And then he's going to give a talk about the work that he's doing. So in terms of that, I think that the maker in residence programs, externally facing outcomes, what I imagine it to be, what I dream forward for it to be, is the launch of a web that, in a similar way to the echo that Heidi described, that one maker after another maker after another maker puts a chain reaction into motion. And when a maker is here with us in residency, they have time to take a long, deep look at the intersection of the work that they're doing, the diaspora that they're a part of, and the entrepreneurial economic factors that impact that work. And they have an opportunity to experiment on developing some kind of a tool that that creates an opportunity for them to turn the tide of the way value flows through their activity in the culture and the world. So when Kudus tells you about Atunda that he's been working on since he's been here, I hope that you'll catch a glimpse of the fact that our maker in residence is working on a technology that could change the way dance and movement is valued in the culture in a way that could completely upend the kind of debates that we have every time we see a new hip hop dance get uploaded into a video game. So those are the kind of external outcomes that I imagine will flow from the center, that will be challenging artists to think like entrepreneurs and to upend the type of pressures that artists are normally in reaction to and become players and makers in the very forces that structure how art gets evaluated in society.
So it is my pleasure to introduce you to Kudus Onikeku, our maker in residence. Kudus is a movement artist made of diversity. Over the decade, he has established himself as one of the preeminent multi-talented artists working today with different media, performance, research, installation, curating, and community organizing. He is the artistic director of Nigeria's preeminent creative organization, Q Dance Center Lagos. Kudus is our inaugural maker here in Kane. His current research investigates the last 6 years of his entrepreneurial work with Q Dance Center. Kudus' international artistic practice intersects between his interest in the visceral body movements, kinesthetic memory, disruptive practices, and finding new vocabularies for performance that aren't centralized in Eurocentric approaches, embracing the artistic vision and a futurist practice that both respects and challenges Yoruba culture and contemporary dance. He has created a substantial body of critically acclaimed work that ranges from solos to group work, as well as an artist-to-artist collaboration with visual artists, architects, musicians, writers, multimedia artists, and even scientists. Ladies and gentlemen, without much further ado, from the Venice Biennale and presently in exhibition as part of the permanent collection of the National Gallery of Canada, I present to you Kudus Onikeku and his performance piece, Right Here, Right Now.
We met her, myself and Haji met in 2004 when she volunteered for my actually very first art project at the age of 20. Just as friends, she volunteered to be part of the, you know, organizers of that event. Then fast forward 2 years later, we started dating, which was also the same time when I was also moving to France for my schooling at the École Nationale des Arts du Cirque in France. So between 2006 and 2009, I was in school. And by 2009, I created my first company in France after school, while Haji was also finishing our own studies of undergraduate study of European languages. By 2010, she was done and she moved to Paris as well for a master's degree in human resources management, which was also at the same time when I was starting my career really as an artist. Then I won this competition, which is like the major competition on the African continent called Dance L'Afrique Dance. And immediately I won that competition, that prize, the number of calls and the number of workload started piling up and I couldn't continue anymore as a solo artist. So I needed a manager. And almost magically, like Haji became my manager. just like that. But this was also at the time where she was also finishing with her master's degree. Immediately she finished from school, then we started full-time working together. So between 2010 and 2013, we were able to make three important works that really kind of like skyrocketed the personal brand and also the name of the company. But that's very idea of success, you know, in a country like France. You know, when you talk about the art world, you know, France is something that is quite sexy. And I also, in 3 years, I just saw the limitation of that organization. That is to say, in my opinion, at that point, the art world itself, you know, was organized. I don't know if it's still, but I have a feeling it's still organized as a kind of a entertainment machine for within a capitalist structure. So I begin to question that its capacity to affect real actual change. When we keep using artists as people who are only good at making works and going on tour and making works again and going on tour and coming back to make more works and going on tour. That model, I realized very quickly that it was not sustainable. And I don't think real stuff can really happen if we are not realizing that artists can also be useful for other kinds of engagement, beginning to interact with real life and real questions that real people are dealing with, and not just locking ourselves within museums and theaters and those kind of spaces. So I decided to let go of my 3 years funding, which was running at the time in Paris, with the Ministry of Culture. You know, we were having funding from 2012 to 2015. At 2013, I decided to stop everything and return to Nigeria. Of course, it was a crazy idea, you know, at that time when you were just like at the beginning of your career, like people started to know your name really in the international scene. And the next thing for us was to return to Nigeria. The reason why we returned to Lagos was really because we realized that at that time, France itself was so established, you know, so big and so huge and so traditional and so much history, and that you cannot just alter anything. You know, you cannot even draw on the wall of the theater. You're like, no, we don't do that here. So for me, thinking of my work as an artist who really want to, you know, break barriers, break boundaries, I realized that going back to Lagos would be the best thing for me, because we now exist within a context where almost everything is possible. And 65% to 70% of the population are young people. So the energy, the ways at which people produce content and innovate was very, very high. We only came for a December break. I remember myself and Aji, we came on holiday in December 2013. And almost naturally, simultaneously, we look at each other like, I think we should return here now. And we went back to Paris in January. And by January, we were back to Lagos. So we returned to Lagos not really, you know, having a prior plan, you know, except the conviction that it is possible to change the world within the scale of a city. But of course, Lagos was not just any kind of city, you know. Lagos is mega. Like, Lagos is there for you. Lagos is energy. But we realized that the way we used to do art in France can no longer continue, because anyway, there are just few theaters around and there is no audience for the kind of things we do. So we have to build everything from scratch. We have to build even the dancers, the artists that we work with. We have to build new kinds of interaction, new kinds of conversation. And ultimately, we realized that we needed to really, at this point, start to think really about art making and business to be able to exist on the edge, if you like. Then we knew that the work of Kudan Center will really be the work of inventing, which is really something, of course, that then have to do a lot with creativity and innovation. So we started off experimenting with all the different kind of ideas. Then eventually, it took us almost 3 to 4 years before we could even write anything about Kudan Center. Like, this is what it is, because it was such an experiment. So today, if you ask me what is Kudan Center, I would say the Kudan Center is a social enterprise that operates as a creative incubator, which applies art making to human resources, innovation, and creativity as capacities for development. And we developed four different kind of umbrellas within which we operate, which is art making, community engagement, talent development, and of course, servicing. Services, mostly because we recognize ourselves as not really into the grant seeking kind of system. It was too slow for us. You know, grant, asking for grant and waiting for it to come before we move was so slow. So we needed to move faster. So we understood that we need to offer services and make money. And while we make money, we can do whatever we want within our other umbrellas, which is art making, community engagement, or talent development. In the last, let's say 10 years, because I include 2010 to this moment, we've been able to leave our imprint in over 50 countries. And we've enjoyed great support and partnership with local and global partners, which includes some of the brands I stated here, Rolex, Institut Français, British Council, Growth Institute, TED Global, Coca-Cola, Bank of Industries in Nigeria, Biennale de Lyon, Lagos State Government. I didn't mention that, actually. We've been really, really supported by them as well. And of course, ultimately, University of Florida, which we're going to see in the next flight, our interaction with the UF. And in the last decade as well of our creative entrepreneurship and experiment, we've nonetheless managed projects internationally at the index of over $3 million. As part of our talent development project that we started 6 years ago, was really deliberate. When we came back to Nigeria, we were very deliberate about the fact that all the people we'll be working with must be between the age range of 16 to 25. We didn't want to go beyond that. And the reason for that was that because we know that the work we want to do is going to take a long time before it germinates, before it starts to produce something. So we were focusing a whole lot of work in talent development, and we were traveling all over Nigeria, not just in Lagos, but in Abuja, in Jos, in Enugu, in Kaduna, in Ibadan. You know, we were moving around. And what we were really looking for was to create a cluster, if you like, of conscious agents, who of course we now refer to as the Q tribe. Our interest really is to gather all these people who are doing groundbreaking stuff in local communities all over Nigeria. And because they themselves, they are already kind of like leaders in their specific communities. So we gather all of them. And most of the time, most of these people, they only get to know of themselves via Instagram. So they only know what somebody is doing. But this project was like the main thing that gathered all of them together and make kind of a cluster. And for me, it's very important to note that this cluster of young people who are emerging dance makers are particularly at the fore of all the Afro dance revolution that is happening on a global scale. And most of the cases, actually a majority of them never left the shore of this country. So for me, it became also very amazing to see the amount of work people are doing within their local context here and how much is resonating across the Atlantic and how much very little is really coming back to them in terms of return and you know, return for their creative and intellectual property. So at the Q-Dance Center, we also take it upon ourselves to kind of like mentor these clusters and for them to be able to take control of their creative content. So this year, a few years ago, 2 years ago, actually, I was and I'm going to reduce the volume a bit so that you can hear me at the same time. I'm going to reduce the volume. We started creating a new work titled Reincarnation. And this has been on for almost 2 years now. I was in Paris in Lyon in 2018. And the director of the Biennale de Lyon, you know, was like, Q, I've been seeing all the things you're doing in Lagos, like, what are you working on next? Of course, I didn't have anything I was working on next, but I was like, yeah, I'm working on a new piece with the cluster. And the title of this piece is Reincarnation. But of course, over time, I started really thinking about what I want to make this piece about. At that time, I was already tired of the role of the choreographer as this ultimate knower of things and who kind of like pass knowledge on to dancers, I was thinking, how can I think of another way of making art making that is not really about the choreographer, but actually focusing on the dancers themselves as collaborators and allowing them to bring in all they have to be able to make it part of the art making process. So I gathered this 10 amazing, really, really amazing 10 dancers who are really at the fore of all the revolution at the moment. And I said to them, I say, okay, people have been using all your works on an international scale without you even having access to even get a visa. So we're gonna make this work that is going to be using your own aesthetics. My role in that space will just be the role of interpreter. I will be the person who will be in between you and the art world, you and the contemporary dance world. I can make that connection because I know it. I know that space and I also know what's happening in Lagos. So reincarnation is really this journey of birth, death, and rebirth, which in a way, it's also kind of like creating its own kind of aesthetics that is very peculiar to what's happening here right now in Nigeria and Lagos specifically. Then for me to be able to take this work to Lyon, to the Biennale de Lyon, is such a groundbreaking thing because Biennale de Lyon in France is the space for contemporary dance conversation and within the European space as well. So for me, that was a mistake. So for me, I wanted to take something that is very raw, you know, from Lagos within a contemporary dance space. And then COVID happened. We were supposed to premiere in September, then that didn't happen. So we are now going to premiere it, which is also kind of like exciting. We're now going to be premiering it at the Centre Georges Pompidou in Paris. For you to know what Centre Georges Pompidou is, this would be like the MoMA of Paris. This would be what MoMA is to New York. Centre Pompidou is to Paris. So for me, within the contemporary art conversation, this is a very, very important space. And not just that, the fact that we will be occupying this space in the whole of January and with this work that is again coming from a very, very local context, I feel like it's very important for us to mention. This video you're watching that just stopped is actually the video that my producer have used to sell almost 40 shows even before anybody saw the piece or know what it is. So as we speak, we are going to be touring in Europe for almost 40 shows between January and July 2021. And also there's also a film adaptation of the work that is also underway with an international crew. Now I'm going to take a moment to speak about dance gathering. The work we were doing at the Q Dance Center, even though it was very local, we were very intentional about the way we tell our stories online, the way we use Facebook, the way we use Instagram. We're very, very deliberate about that. And in a way, it started kind of like creating echoes. What that meant is that as 6 years ago, we already knew that there is a limit to what we can do within the physical space, because the world now begins to exist mostly within the digital world. So what we do locally was very important for us to also have a resonance on a global scale. And that kind of like worked. You know, everything we do, we package it to be able to show it also for an online audience. And very quickly, people started kind of like writing us from everywhere, like they want to be part of what we're trying to achieve. And we realized that our community, our sense of community was growing even farther than what we can manage within Nigeria. So we started dance gathering really with that in mind. Like, how can we go to a space where we can open up this network that we are developing to a much more larger community of people who are also in a way beginning to think of alternatives, who are beginning to get tired of the ways at which the art world exists or the ways at which their own local context exists, and begin to create intercommunal partnership whereby different communities are coming together to interact and to exchange. At the same time, at that time I was quite tired also about this whole idea of festivals whereby you just come as an artist, you show your work and you leave, another one comes, show their work and they leave. And I'm like, so what is festival about this? In our own context, festival is really more about gatherings and meeting new people and collaborating and exchanging ideas. And that was precisely what we made dance gathering to be. So artists that come for dance gathering don't are told not to bring anything. They don't bring their work. They don't bring anything they make, but they come as themselves, and with the hope that they will meet amazing people like themselves, and they will be able to collaborate with them and exchange ideas with them. And that for me was the ways at which we begin to establish a kind of a cohort of global creatives from over 60 cities globally. We begin to interact and intersect. And apart from the thing that we come to create in Nigeria, what is most important is how all of that continue to resonate even after, way after the gathering, where you see people collaborating between Chicago and Paris, or between Jos and Berlin, or between Johannesburg and São Paulo, which really doesn't come back to even take permission from whatever we're doing in Lagos. And that is what we are also trying to do on a much more global level. Then this year, I'm gonna play also this, and I'm gonna take out the sound as well. And this year, we were supposed to go again for the third edition of Dance Gathering, which became problematic. Dance Gathering was supposed to hold from 18th to 19th of April, like the final weekend. Then COVID happened in March. So in less than a month, we had to think of creative ways, innovative way to move an event that happens within a context like this online. Because the way Dance Gathering work is that people gather for 2 weeks or 1 week, and we take them to these streets we are seeing in the video right now on the day one of it. And we say, this is the street, and look at it, look around, we walk through it. What do you want to do? What would you like to do? And who would you like to do it with? So the whole point of the festival is that during the entire 1 week process, people are interacting and exchanging ideas and workshopping ideas together. And eventually on the final weekend, which is Saturday and Sunday, we throw everything on the street. And so we were like, how do you then do that online? Because there's something about Dance Gathering, which means that you need to be there for you to experience it. Now, how do you get that experience within a virtual space? So we started gathering this 135 artists from the global, from different cities, and we brought them together to examine what does it mean for us at this time to work from home, and also what does it mean virtuality within our own context. But a year before that, we've already chosen our theme. This is the hand, the future is black. And we realized that how do we achieve that? How do we even understand that we announced the end of the world even before the world ended? And the whole idea was for us to gather all these materials and collaborate and exchange with people, and then put all of these people to come together within a particular time that is set as 12 noon Lagos time, and allow all of everybody to kind of like tuning into Lagos time. And there was about 5 hours long of material that was gathered. And within a period of 5 hours, about 10,000 people gathered over a weekend from about 56 different countries. And that was also kind of like one of the things we did this year. So on that note, when we did the gathering, the material, the 5 hours material that came, we realized that we needed to do something with it. Then we started Afropolis.org. Afropolis.org, really, I invite you to check it out. It's really, for us, it's a digital performance space where there are different kind of interaction possible within that space. There's also a classroom, there's also a video room, and of course, a series of exhibition. Presently, we are hosting Afrobeats, which is the current exhibition that is going on in the video room. I invite you also to also check that out. Now, to go directly to the focus of my research at the UF between now and 2022, between, of course, 2019 and 2022. So it's been almost a year now that we've been engaging this, what it means to be a maker within our context. And really, if you've been listening to all the things that both myself, Oshubi, Onye, everybody has been saying, we realize that the main question for us at this point is, can we copyright a dance move? It feels like kind of an obvious question, but it isn't. Because the law is quite ambiguous about that. And in my opinion, it's quite retarded and also racist, because the kind of dance that the law says we can copyright is when you make a full piece, a full length work. But when you talk about dance moves or a groove, or, you know, when we see salsa movement, we all can recognize it, just the basics. You know, when you see house dance, the basics, you can recognize that. When you see capoeira, the basics, you can recognize that. It is not a composition. It's just a groove, the unit of groove. And if you tell me that I cannot copyright that, then you are taking away everything from African and African diaspora people, because the way dance for us exists within a context whereby you do something, somebody picks it up somewhere else and do something else with it and become something else. Then, so there is this capacity for constant alteration and constant regeneration. There's this level of birth, death, and rebirth that's actually constantly happening within our own context. And if games like Fortnite are beginning to take from those particular kinds of cultures, and because they know that the law is retarded and racist, there are presently about 10 different lawsuits against Fortnite. But of course, they all keep losing, because Fortnite is protected by law that they can actually use dance moves without paying for it. And for us, we are asking this very difficult question, that can we at this point of our advancement create technologies that can really help us solve this problem of appropriation? Because as we know it, the ethics of intellectual property has been broken by the internet or by reality. And that the big one for us is that, especially in the United States at the moment, there's this question of diversity, equity, inclusion that is going on. And I find it quite funny that we are still talking about wealth redistribution. And I'm like, can we already kind of plan for a pre-distribution before we get into everybody's bank account? Can we already start to use technology as a way to identify and distribute before you can start talking about creating a gift, you know? Because when you look at Beyoncé's latest work, The Gift, you ask yourselves, who is really gifting who? Because at the end of the day, the bottom line for all of that is that who is getting more wealthier is Disney and Beyoncé. But the culture that is at the background of all the cultural aesthetics that was used, they're still there asking for permission to even get to see their works. Because as you may know, in Africa, when we tried to watch Black is King, we couldn't, because Disney is not allowing us to watch it on the continent at the moment. So for me, all of this is quite important at this point of our development as a unit of humanity. Then we are coming up with Atunda, which is a project that Oshubi already mentioned. Atunda will harvest a big amount of dance moves, and we turn dance into data, into protocols that create unique movement fingerprints for dances. And the purpose of this is to create new economic opportunity for creators of value. This will invariably lay a background for cutting-edge interactive system to synthesize, protect, remotely teach, or collaborate. Furthermore, Atunda will revolutionize kinesthetic learning and transmission in the age of AI, blockchains, machine learning, and data security. This is equally, in my opinion, moving us from the Eurocentric notion of dance notation to a much more universal language of dance coding and codification, using motion capture technology that records not just the form, but can equally give an account of the unit of groove within a dance move. And of course, this would be of great importance to all the world's cultures that have been left in the margins in the history of dance, which, as we know, is very, very Eurocentric oriented. I think on that note, I will give it back to Onye. Thank you.
Yeah, Q. Wonderful.
Yes, thank you so much. So our first maker in residence, y'all, Kudus Onyekeku. Thank you so much for that presentation. I'm gonna let Q catch his breath and get a drink of water or something, and then we're gonna bring him right on back for a little bit of a talk back. So many powerful nuggets of information. You can see that Q Dance Center is a came in their own right, a center for art migration and entrepreneurship and the way the company itself is actually structured. And my Nigerian brother, for those of you that don't know, Nigerians pride ourselves on bombasticness, if that's even a word. We declared the end of the world before the world actually ended. And then as some people in the chat were noting, the audacious yet subtly, the subtle turn of the phrase that instead of redistributing wealth, could we redistribute wealth. And the way that that phrase in and of itself just sort of like lands this nugget of what the types of questions are that we're trying to ask in the center. I've been thinking in getting this presentation ready for you all. I've been thinking a lot about the series of events and the way that diaspora networks work that led me to even meet Kudus, which was in the digital space for years and years as he was troublemaking in Lagos and laying out all of these narratives and questions and arguments on Facebook. Years ago, I made a piece called Sambo's Sister, which was based on the intersection of blackface performance and Eshu Elegua, which was actually based on my teacher that I talked about today, W.T. Lehman. And Kudus got his hands on the pamphlet of that performance. And through that interaction, through our artwork, and the way that our connection within the African diaspora linked us. And then years later, I was able to, actually, Q, are you ready? Come back, because I have my first question.
I'm here.
There, okay. Yeah, so thank you so much for the presentation. And we are so blessed to have you as our inaugural maker in residence. I think that there's a way in which the way that you are inhabiting the role and the way that your projects, not just you and Haji and Q Dance and the work that you're doing in the world, the way that it is inhabiting the role of the maker in residence is informing, it's helping form us, and it's helping inform our gathering and our gathering networks. And laying the gauntlet down for the type of work that we can and will be doing here. And I just remember how hard it was for me to get you to apply. So I wonder if you can talk about that, about the decision to, because clearly you are busy, fully occupied, you weren't looking for something else to do or someplace else to go. So if you can talk a little bit about that, and maybe that connects to the work of the center and your work and your visions, of what our future might be.
I remember that. Of course, we because we've been talking even before you went to the UF, I kind of knew why you went there and all the amazing amount of work that you are already in the process of, all the things you achieved in Chicago at Columbia College, and how coming to UF was like kind of a continuation of that trajectory. So I was at the beginning just excited about what you are doing personally. And then you came back and say, oh, would you apply? I'm like, I was just supporting you. I didn't know that I was going to like physically come there to do it with you. And I know that it was a tough decision, but I don't know if you were not there, I don't know if I would be here. Because for me, one thing I didn't mention is that you have been there from the beginning of Dance Gathering. The first edition in 2017, you were there. And I remember the conversation I had with you after the first edition. And you're like, don't worry, I'll help you. And it was just like a magician. And it actually became the thing that made 2018 edition so special, because you decided to take it upon yourself to support. So because of that, really, even I never told you before, I felt very indebted to also do the same thing. Like, I feel like whatever you are building, wherever you are, I owe you to be able to bring what I am doing to come and support. So for me, I couldn't, if it was someone else, I would have said no, for sure. 3 years out of Lagos at this time, impossible. like this is the time where things are becoming in Lagos. And this is not the time to leave Lagos. So for me, I knew that with you as well, I could, because you understand what the work is in Lagos as well. So I could maybe be flexible enough to keep both this one going and that one going. But because also as an artist, especially the moment I left for France, I have understood that I can no longer belong entirely to one place. I will always operate at the edge. So for me, that's why even sometimes when we have the conversation in Gainesville, and you want to drag me into some localized stuff, I'm like, hey, listen, I've gone beyond that now. I'm not settling. I don't even understand what it means to be a migrant. I'm a mover. I'm a traveler. So I feel like, if you remember, I don't know if you remember, when I send my cover letter for the application, I said, I remember I sent it to a friend. If you're like, oh, QQ, this is too much. I mean, get there before you start shaking things. I'm like, no, I need to write it this way so that if they select me, they already know that I said it from my application, that I heard that you guys are trying to make magic. And I'm interested in magic.
Okay. Yeah. I didn't know that you were going to answer that question like that. It's not all about me, but I appreciate that. And I also appreciate the way it's an example of community economics, and the way that connections through cultural diasporas lead to mutual support of economic activity, and that there's tangible and intangible values that exchange across those. I also don't know if you know that I also recruited at least 4 other people for that position, and some of them are hot on your heels. Their faces are here in the Zoom room now. So don't worry. Don't worry. But this was a magical match. And I look forward to you being the first, and that we will have maker after maker after maker, and your network will connect to the next maker's network, will connect to the next maker's network, and that the tools that the tool that Artunda proposes, that dance can be data, at the moment that AI is starting to dawn as a tool for the way that society may start to reorganize itself, that dance could be data, and data can be codified, and code can be IP, and IP can be paid for. If you just think about all of the dancers that made Michael Jackson, the dancers that made Broadway, all the Harlem dancers that Broadway dancers would go from downtown New York to Harlem to learn the latest moves that were coming off of the streets, the generations of street dancers that powered the aesthetics of popular culture and the billion-dollar bank accounts of pop culture and entertainment. And to think that you could potentially create a tool that could pre-distribute wealth back to the pockets of the movers who actually make it. It's huge.
Yeah, 1 minute silence to that.
Okay. I have a question. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
So Q, it's Augusto talking. Hey, so one thing that just came to my mind now was, so do you feel that pre-distribution can work in a capitalist system, or would we have to change the system to make it work?
I think, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was Ashilimbembe that was saying something about, we must organize for capitalism to destroy itself. Because that's the only way it can be destroyed. Nothing else can destroy it. And for me, science, mathematics can do that. We can calculate it. And with the blockchain technology, we've realized that we can actually decentralize even the whole money system, how money moves. So for me, it's really, of course, what I'm saying here now is only an aspiration, right? It's not like we've done the work. The work, while we do the work, we will come across all the problems and all the solution that is necessary for the problem to be solved. But it was just an idea that, is it possible? And with the extraordinary people that I've met at UF, they made it seem like actually it can be done, you know? Digital worlds are like, yes, we can do it. And I think for me, that's the most important thing, that, like I said, we're trying to make magic and we're trying to take back our power. It's not gonna be easy. It's gonna be a whole lot of work. And that's why we're working on this. If it was gonna be easy, I don't think we would be doing it anyway.
Anyone else?
Well, yeah, I guess I'm not done. Sorry, if it becomes too conversational, then we can move on, because it's making me think of possibly the need to, you know, when we're thinking about pre-distribution. First of all, I love this idea. To me, it's really inspiring. So thank you for that. But I'm thinking that, you know, we need, I guess, places to contain, you know, and to accumulate, I guess, until it gets to a point that it can be dispersed. So, I don't know, for some reason, just started to generate like structures, you know, ideas of structures in my head that I was curious to know if you've already started to think about, you know, structures that to make certain things possible.
For me, I think the first thing first is really about, and again, maybe I didn't mention it enough, it's not a project that I myself personally is going to achieve all by myself. No, there is going to be a whole bunch of conversation with different dance communities and dance leaders in different countries. Because at the end of the day, to be able to define the parameters or even to be able to define, because just like the AI conversation, AI needs data, and it needs to learn. You know, machine learning is about learning, and learning is about who is teaching. If you have a very good teacher, you will learn very well. So I myself, I cannot claim to understand Latin American dances, African dances, hip hop, salsa, all of that. No. So one of the things that we're thinking, of course, we still have to think really about it at this point, is to at some point within the process of the research, when the moment we are done with the technology, building the technology that can house all of that, then we need to gather thought leaders in the dance world on a global scale within a kind of a conference where it becomes like the main conversation. How do we create that data together? So that at the end of the day, when we begin to do machine learning, the machine is really learning from people who have real authority within every genre or every style, or I don't know what to call it, but every possibility that are there. And the moment we're able to do that, we are able to, at least to a large extent, deal with the conversation around known stuffs. Now I'm talking about the emerging ones. That for me, this is like the most exciting one. The one that is somebody's going to invent a movement tomorrow. That's the one that is most exciting for me. Because that's actually what the digital technology is doing for us now. The rate at which, exactly, especially in Lagos, the rate at which new dance moves get invented, even before you learn the first one, another 10 is waiting for you. So for me, how do we protect those ones? Because it feels like it's almost kind of like obvious how to protect capoeira, how to protect salsa, because there is already a community around it. But I'm talking about all the people that are suing Fortnite. These are people who are just inventing movement. It has nothing to do with a culture, really. These are people who are just inventing stuff. And now, even if this is not going to solve the problem for all the things that have happened in the last 100 years, but what about the thing that's about to happen in the next 100 years?
Well, you know, one of the things that to me makes it really appealing about collecting this data is the fact that we can actually capture the specificity of the individual, which I feel is really special, you know, and to know that, you know, the specific way that I move within my physical body, that it can be captured and then, you know, potentially monetized. it's really interesting, you know, because it's like, you know, linking the source to, you know, to the outcome. And that's, I don't know that I've seen that before.
I don't think so.
Well, okay.
All right. Thank you, Augusto.
Thank you.
Well, we're hitting around 8:35 right now. I can feel the energy is cresting, and I think that we should maybe call ourselves to a close, as we're all so our hearts are full and our minds are full and our hope for the future is full. And in this moment, maybe focus some of that energy on the future of our nation and the questions that are sitting before us in the next few months. May we rise to the opportunity with bravery and with the full potential of the human race, all fully represented. Oshibi, you want to close us out?
I just wanted to quickly say thank you to everyone. Thank you for taking the time to join us this evening. We are excited about the present and really excited about the future of the center. Thank you, Onye. Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Heidi. Thank you, Ramon. And definitely thank you, Caduce. But I want to definitely give a shout to everyone who behind the scenes made this happen. Holly Franklin, Brandon McKinney, Barb Matola, and of course, Kathy McKee. This has been an amazing undertaking to get us to this moment. And we are really thankful and excited about what's coming next. As you see up, this is the way to get in contact with us. We ask that you definitely reach out because we are just at the beginning and we are definitely looking for your assistance to help connect, collaborate, and catalyze the work of the center. And with that, I say thank you and good night. And we will sit here in the chat and continue to keep the conversation going until the last person is here. But thank you so much for your time this evening, and we look forward to connecting with you soon.